Today I'm joined by Bernard Rowe from ioneer Limited. Bernard, nice to see you.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. Great to be here.
Give us a little reminder about your project in Nevada, Bernard.
So Rhyolite Ridge is a lithium-boron project. It's one of only two lithium-boron deposits known anywhere in the world. So it's really an unusual deposit. And we've just completed last week a feasibility, a definitive feasibility study on the project. So it's quite an advanced project.
So 18 months here of hard work to get to the DFS. What came out of it?
So, yes, that's right. It was 18 months of really solid work, many aspects of that, of course, to that work. The compelling economics are the highlight that came from the study. The study returned, showed an after-tax NPV of $1.2 billion, an unlevered after-tax internal rate of return of 21%, annual revenues of approximately $422 million and annual EBITDA of $288 million from the revenue generated from both the lithium and the boron streams that will be produced.
Tell us more then, what makes this project special? What makes it unique? Give us a bit more detail on that.
So it is very much to do with the combination of lithium and boron, and I said that's a really rare combination globally. There's a whole lot of reasons why those two elements are complementary in this deposit. Firstly, it's the key to behind the processing, the simple acid leaching process that we use to extract the lithium. So unlike other hard rock lithium deposits, spodumene deposits, which will require high temperature roasting to liberate the lithium, that is not required at Rhyolite Ridge. It's a fairly straightforward crush and acid leach to liberate the lithium and the boron. And that's very much related to the minerals that are present in the deposit. The complementary nature also extends to the economics, because whilst lithium, particularly in recent times, pricing and has been somewhat volatile, and obviously it's a very rapid growing industry, and there'll be ups and downs in supply and demand. Boron, on the other hand, is a very, very stable market. It's been stable for a very long period of time. The pricing has been very stable. So in terms of revenue production, the two are very complementary.
What did you say the lithium resources that you're sitting on?
So the total resource is 146 million tonnes of ore. Of that, we have already defined a 60 million tonne reserve that's been drilled out. And that's the mine plan that is in the feasibility study. It exploits just the 60 million tonne reserve, plus a small amount of resource of 4 million tonnes, but essentially it's all reserve. That's sufficient for 26 years of production. Production rates are of the order of 22,000 tonnes of lithium hydroxide per year and 174,000 tonnes of boric acid a year. Making it, one of the larger, certainly top 10 producers in the world of lithium, and probably the third largest producer of boron in the world, of boric acid in the world.
So the end markets that you're targeting, what are we talking, EVs and batteries?
Yes, exactly. So for the lithium, it's primarily the lithium ion battery market, and particularly for the EVs. Now, we mentioned that the deposit's located in Nevada in the United States. The United States is the second largest vehicle fleet in the world. And we see going forward, as that vehicle fleet is electrified, which we think will happen, reasonably quickly, then there's going to be incredible domestic demand for lithium in the United States, for lithium ion batteries. And we also think there's going to be increasing scrutiny around the domestic supply chain around those batteries, which means the US will need a domestic supply of lithium and other battery raw materials. And currently, the US produces no lithium that goes into lithium ion batteries. It produces about 4,000 tonnes per annum, but that's not used in lithium ion battery manufacture. So very, very, very low base. And in fairly short order, it's going to need hundreds of thousands of tons of lithium if it was to supply all of its requirements domestically.
So what are your next steps then? Are you looking at conversations around financing?
Yes, we are. We own the project 100%. And we certainly see a key element in the funding solution to developing the project, which we intend to do. A key element of that is strategic partnering. And so, you know, we've already been talking to many different types of strategic partner, from investment partners through to offtake partners and a combination of thereof. Chemical auto company partners, and so you know, we will be over the next 3 to 6 months, we will be continuing those discussions that we've already initiated, and obviously the definitive feasibility study was a key part in the development of the discussions around partnerships going forward.
What kind of construction and build time frame you're looking? Is it about 12, 18 months or thereabouts?
Yes, it's so. If I just take a step back, the first part of that time table is the permitting process and this and the partnering process, because you know we won't go forward until we've got the project permitted, obviously, and we have a partner on board. So that's going to happen over the next 12 months. So mainly driven by the permitting process. We anticipate in around this time next year being in a position of having the project permitted by the federal government and state government in Nevada. And from that point, which would be a final investment decision, it's about a two-year build period. So from early 2021 through until about early 2023 would be the build period. And so first production sort of second quarter of 2023, which we think is really great timing in terms of, you know, yes, we are in a depressed sort of pricing environment at the moment, and overlaid on that is the recent downward pressure created by the disruption around COVID-19. But, you know, we think 2023 through to 2025 is going to be the period where we're seeing, you know, large uptake in electric vehicles, that car companies that have already indicated that they're going to move in that direction will really ramp up their production and increasing number of models, and that there will be really, really strong demand for lithium, particularly lithium hydroxide, for batteries in electric vehicles.
Bernard, nice to see you. Thanks very much.
Pleasure, Andrew. Great to be with you. Thank you.